Good point. Go ahead.
All right. Yeah. Thanks for this intro. I feel very special now. Cool. Yeah. You made a good point already, saying that it's very close to what you get when you're a designer and you want to actually publish something. The nice thing is it's very immediate, and you publish something, and the whole world can see it. That's a really cool thing, and I totally agree with that. So I prepared a little bit something. I've used this already at some other occasion at university, but just a bit of background information about HTML, hypertext markup language it's called. And it's invented by this guy, Tim Berners-Lee, whom you might have heard of before. Actually, Sir Tim Berners-Lee. By now, I think he was, how's that verb called when you get the sir or whatever that verb is? He invented what's called today the World Wide Web. So by inventing this hypertext markup language, he enabled researchers at the institute he was working at to link documents and all that stuff. And from then, everything else happened. So he is the inventor of it. I hope you can all hear me well. If something is wrong, just let me know. So you might have seen in line of HTML something called tags, and especially these braces and these signs that are often used in terms of coding, because they always symbolize what this is about. So they are the building blocks of a web page, and mostly you have to open these tags and close them. And often they have attributes. We won't talk about those today, but just so you know. And they can be nested, so it can be levels of tags, and we will see this in a minute. So this is a typical tag, and they always have some kind of short, let's say, abbreviation. This one stands for headline tag, and there's 6 headline tags. And then you open the tag here on the left side, and on the right side, you close it with a slash. That's the typical syntax, how you write it. And in between the tags, you put whatever content you want to put. And the whole thing is called an element, more or less. So typically, you need to open and close tags. So here's other tags that are self-closing or standalone. Like for line breaks, you can just make a break, or a horizontal rule when you create like just a line that you want to separate something, or an image. It doesn't close. Now, why that is, I'm not sure. It would be nicer sometimes that they're all the same syntax, but some tags are just standing there by themselves. We'll see that in a minute when we look at some examples. And then let's take a quick look at the anchor tag that you use to create a link. Without links, internet would be boring. So this is the main interaction tag, let's say. So you put your URL that you want to link to in this attribute. And these attributes are, there's different attributes for each tag, but this one is the most important one for the anchor tag. So this is the key for the attribute and the value that you put in quotes here. All right, so hope you can follow me for now. And there's different ways of nesting. So you can have a paragraph here. The P stands for paragraph. And within the paragraph, you have a list that would be an ordered list. And then you have list items and all these things. But let's try this out in a minute. But this is the general anatomy, how tags and how code, HTML code works. Really simple. You just have to write your text and put it in tags. There's many different tags, and there's lots of sites where you can look them up. This is just a short list of common tags, let's say. You can look them up here or here on this link. And I'll share these slides, of course, in the channel. And I can actually put them in the chat if you want to take a look already. Let's do that quickly. So let's do it. Let's create a web page. And this is the basic structure, but how do we do this? This is maybe a bit complicated. How are we going to do this? So there's lots of different tools that you can use nowadays. If you do it on a professional kind of level, then you would use what's called an editor or integrated development environment, an IDE. But we won't do that today. We will just do it in the browser. And there's lots of coding sandboxes and playgrounds that you can use to do that. Really dozens of them. You can use lots of them. But today we'll use JS Fiddle, which I kind of like. You don't have to register to use it. You can just use it straight up. So let's try this one. When you open it, it shows you this kind of thing here. And you can change the layout, but what you have here is when you open it the first time, you will have this classic layout. You can basically change it. Here's your HTML code. There's your CSS code, which I get to later, JavaScript, which we won't do today. And then it shows the result on this one. But I'll change the layout to this tab-based layout, which is a bit simpler to look at for my purpose today. So here, basically, you can just write tags and write HTML. For example, I want to write an H1 tag. I would start like this, but it just shows the text. Now, if I hit now my tab key, and let me actually share my my keystroke so you can see that. 1 second. So if I write this now, you should see my keystrokes in the lower left corner. And if I hit the tab key now, it will auto-complete my tag. So very often it looks like very bloated, but a lot of things you don't type, you do this auto-completion a lot and you do a lot of copy-pasting actually. So here I could start writing my title and it would appear here in my results window. So this is the H1 tag, the headline one, and then you have another headline, let's say here, and you would write text, the basics of HTML and CSS. And that's how you kind of write it. And you can write the paragraph tag, you just autocomplete it basically, and you would write text in here. And then there's something called unordered lists, what I've already talked about. You can write it like this. Hang on, you hit the tab key. Once you know how it works, it's really not so difficult. You just need to know these tags. But a lot of times you just copy and paste stuff as well, and then you just kind of insert it again. And here what you see, the output is just an HTML web page. Can you follow me so far? Or is anybody, if you have any question, just let me know, or you can also post it in the chat, of course. So this might look at the beginning, when you first start writing stuff, it might look very odd to see the tags always in between here. But it just helps you to structure your page basically and to later be able to style it, because as you can see it now, this looks very basic. It's just the way the browser styles it automatically. If you don't apply any style to it, there's a default styling. So the headline is a bit bigger than the second headline, and the paragraph has a certain styling, and the list also has a certain styling. It also has these list item icons already built in, so it just works without doing anything. But the nice thing, of course, and that's where the design stuff comes into play, that you can actually manipulate all these things and style it and add some colors and all of these things. So, of course, we want to do that today because we want to see something visual happening as well. And let me briefly show you what I mean here. So we want to add some style now to our HTML, and that is done with CSS, cascading style sheets. So you use basically HTML to build like a structure, to add your content, to create building blocks and kind of like a scaffold. And the CSS, you use it to lay out your things and to add style and colors and kind of look and feel. So there's a, you separate these two things. It's kind of like when you build a house, you have kind of a structure and your walls and all these things, and you add the paint and all decoration later. That's how you can kind of look at it. And CSS is applied through different rules and selectors. It gets quite complicated at some point, but I wouldn't necessarily say it's programming. It's more like knowing what property to apply at what point. It can get a bit messy, but HTML is a bit simpler in that sense, but CSS can get a bit messy. You just need to know your way around how to use what properties. The nice thing also is that a lot of properties, if you attended the Webflow masterclass of Daniel, actually, he showed some of the properties that you can edit. And basically what you edit there in Webflow visually, you would do in CSS by typing it out. And also there you do a lot of auto completion and just don't have to type everything specifically. But let's take a look at an example here. So here's the common properties that exist. Sort of there's color, of course. So this is the text color, basically. Background color is the for a whole box or a whole element, the background color. You can also do gradients or background images like this one. Then you can add borders. You can use, of course, different fonts and typography stuff. Change it up a little bit. And this is the basic stuff. You can align text and align layouts, of course, and you can do many more, much more complicated things. But this is the basic things that you can use to style your text and your layout, basically. How to do it? So you add CSS to your web page and mix it up, sort of. Basically, if you do it technically, you would add a file, one or more different files that have CSS in them. But what we will do now is we will just do that within this browser tool, because it allows you to do that without having to know any coding. And I will, I can also, if you want to try it later, I'll share this file with you and we can do a try kind of hands-on session. So let's go to this second tab here, the CSS tab, and add some CSS. We want to change the color of the whole document, let's say. So if you want to write something in CSS, you can do it different ways. You can write, let's say, the tag that you want to target. This would be the main outside tag of the whole document, your HTML document, basically. And then you have to open it with a curly brace and close it. And within these braces, you write your properties. So here I would just now write the color property. I could also do COL and do auto completion. It auto completes with columns, which is kind of weird, but in this case, I would write it out. Typically, the editors will do some smart auto-completion. And there's some colors. You can use RGB codes or hex codes or anything that Figma or Sketch or Photoshop or whatever offers you. Color, you can just paste it in here. You can also use some predefined colors like blue, for example. And now, as you've seen it, the changes to blue here, my text. It changes now, the whole document changes to blue or red because I apply it to my main tag, kind of. I can also apply different colors to each element. So let's add something else here. This is how you write it, basically. You write the name of the property and then a colon, and then you write the value of the property and it ends with a semicolon. So here I'm going to add now background color. Let's do a light gray, for example. So now this part is still white. And I believe this is a technical thing of the, I don't know why it actually does that right now. Oops. Probably have to do it on another element. Don't worry about this now. Yeah, okay. and have to do it on both elements here, on the HTML tag and the body tag, which is something you don't need to worry about now, but just so you know. So this is the basic format. Let's do green, for example. Or as I said, you can also do something like an RGB code here. So if I wanted to do like a full red, I would do like this. Then it would be red again. If I want to add a bit of green to it, I would mix it up to create an orange. I hope this makes sense so far. Let's say I wanted to change now the font. I can do that as well. And there's something called font family. Let's try that. Let's create like a simple Arial font here. And it changes immediately to that font family. You can also integrate Google fonts and all these things. And that's how it basically works. So you basically the combination of properties and values and the depending on where you place them and on which element creates a different kind of setting. So let's say I wanted to now add a different color for the headlines and a different one for the text. I can do that. Let's go back here and do this one black. But for the headline, for that first one, I want to do it orange. So now I change it because I'm only addressing all H1 tags. So if I add another one here in my HTML, like this, for example, it will also apply the same style. So you can, it will be applied anywhere you use this tag, not only once, but anytime you use it. That's the basic concept of it. Does that make sense so far? Or anybody has a question? I see thumbs up. Cool. All right. So, but sometimes it's a bit too complicated to apply a style to all tags, because sometimes you want to be a bit more specific, and that's when you use something called classes. And a class is basically, let me see if I have this here. Yeah, this is basically if you add style to your tags. So you can add it to each tag as you like, and it would just be working straight up. What you can also do is do something like this, write a class. It has to start, it must start with a dot and then with a alphabetic letter, cannot start with a number or something. And this is used to, basically you can apply it to certain tags and reuse it elsewhere. So it's kind of like creating a text style or a layer style in Sketch or Figma or whatever, or in Word, if you create like a text format and you save it, this is the corresponding thing in CSS. You can just kind of reuse it. Instead of saying every title on my page will look in a certain way, you name that style actually to anything you want and you apply it to your tag. This happens a lot on a daily basis if you write CSS. So let's try that. It's a different way of addressing things. So let's say I want to have a title or headline class. I could do it like this. And actually the editor shows me now that I'm not addressing a tag, but I've written a class. It shows me this in orange here, which is quite nice. So I can differentiate that in my code here. And let's say for the headline class, I want to have a different font. Let's go back to old school Times New Roman here. And we will apply it now to this first title here. And how do we do this? We have to go here into the tag and add an attribute. and we just write class here, and then we write the name of the class that we've given. So it's headline. And now, as you've seen, the change to Times New Roman. So I could now add different properties, of course, here. Maybe I add the font size a bit bigger. Let's do 50 pixels, a big one. And I could also change it to be underlined, for example. And I'm writing now this very quickly, but typically you would just need to write something like this and it will autocomplete. So it's a lot of time you don't have to type this, you just kind of copy paste it or have it autocompleted. So this is the basic principle how things work. Do you want to try it? Or who would like to try it? I can share this.
Of course.
Of course. So how about this? I share this document. Actually, I've prepared another one that you can use. So I've put the mini masterclass invitation in HTML. And you see here the text that it was in Slack. Actually, there's still the icon. Let's remove that. And down here is the image. And we have basically, let's go through it. You can ignore what's up here, but this is your basic structure. And you can add other information to your document. But what you're interested in is this part within your body tag. So within that body section, I have a few paragraphs. There's a link to the Zoom. There's an attribute with the actual URL. And then all the way to the bottom, there is a image. And actually, I forgot to close the proper tags here. It still often works. It's not like it's very, let's say, HTML is fairly not so sensitive, let's say. it will allow certain errors and still work. It's not like some other program where everything breaks down. You sometimes don't know what's happening, but this actually works sometimes even if you forget certain things. So let me save this and I will share this in the channel and you can open it up in your browser. And basically just try it. So you have some text already written and you could go into the CSS and try a few properties. You can try that with the color, for example. Let me show you this again, how this works. So try to use maybe a color of your choice. You can use a name or use a hex code or RGB code. Or you can use a background color. Just try to apply maybe these basic properties here to start with colors. And then try maybe something with typography. Change the font size or make it a bit bolder, underline it. I'll give you a few minutes to try it. Let's say 5 minutes. And then I'll have a bit more advanced example. Is that cool for everybody? Sure, that's fine. People have called me Dinky before, it's fine. So I'll give you just a chance to try it. And then if you have a question, let me know. But basically you can open that page and try to put some properties into the tags and apply it like this here. I'll leave that open so you can see it. And I will give you time until 1:45 just to try a few moves, your first moves in CSS. And if you have a question, just let me know. Well, I suppose you heard that, Daniel, but just to repeat, I will just try until 1:45. And I shared the link to my template.
Yes, cool. I saw it. I'll have a look at them.
Okay.
This waiting music is perfect. You know, it's just like this background thing.
That's pretty good. I hope it doesn't put you to sleep.
Very awake. Too many coffees for that.
So you have another minute to try it out, and then I'll show you a few other things. If you're familiar with Sketch or similar, you could also, you know, use some color from there and just take it. I could also show you how this works. That's the typical process that you design something in your Sketch version, all right? Design something in Sketch or Figma or Experience Design or something. And then, let me just move this so you can still see it. And then, basically, if you have a color here, you would take this value, for example, that's the hexadecimal value. You could take it or choose a different color first. Let's say kind of a pale red. Take that color and just use it straight here in your document. Just need to use a hash in front of it if you're doing the hexadecimal. And there you go. All right, I hope everybody had at least a little try on it. The nice thing about the internet or World Wide Web in general, internet and World Wide Web is actually not the same, but the web, let's say in general, every web page, basically, let's say Factory Berlin page, let's go there quickly. Every web page, you can actually take a look at the whole CSS and the whole HTML code. So it's very open. So if I wanted to know how this is layouted and what color this is, I can find out by using the browser inspector. This is a bit techy, but basically what you do in Chrome or Firefox or Safari even, you right click on it. That's the simplest way of doing it. And then you have something called inspect. You can just basically open that and open the so-called inspector. And when you open it the first time, it will be attached to the bottom of your screen like this. And there you basically see HTML of the web page. There you see the CSS and the style that actually ends up being used. This is quite nice. So this looks very complicated, but let's just focus on this paragraph here. So you can see there's a paragraph tag for this specific paragraph. You see the content of it. and you see the styling of it. So it has a font weight, which is basically the weight of the font, how thick it is, sort of. You can use margins, for example, how far it is away, the distance from other elements. And here you see the font size. So I could actually go here and change it if I like. And just for that instance that I'm using it, it would be changed. If I reload the page, it's gone. But just if I wanted to see how it looks, I could change it up a little bit. And I can also find out what classes are used. So here's a class called text headline, and it's being applied to my paragraph. And like this, I can sometimes look at certain web pages and think, oh, okay, well, how did they do this? I want to see what technique they used, or how they actually came up with it, or what color are they using, or something like that. And you can just go into the inspector and find out exactly what you need. So here it tells you actually it's using the Akkurat standard font. So in case you're looking for that, there's also browser plugins they can use to do that. For example, Font Face Ninja I use a lot to find that out. But you can also take a look in the CSS and it will typically tell you. And all the values that this specific paragraph is actually using, it shows you here. So this is quite handy. If you want to use the inspector, just right click anywhere, or you can also use a shortcut. Command Alt I, or on Windows probably Control Option I. But it's simpler if you're just starting off to just right click anywhere on the page or on the element that you want to inspect, and then you just open the inspector. What you can also do is look at the source code just straight up, and that you could do with, actually, I don't know where the menu item is. Let me just find it. It's this shortcut here where you can see all the HTML. How do I open it? Actually, I never used the window. The menu item for that. I think it's here somewhere. Edit. I haven't used it in ages, straight up. Let me just check web dev here. No, it's not here. Not sure how to open that. But anyway, to see that code, you can just hit command option U, and then it'll actually open the complete HTML page and the whole source code, basically. And you can kind of go through it. This looks obviously very complicated when you've never dealt with it, but after a while of reading HTML, you kind of get used to it. But I still have troubles reading something like this, where there's lots of classes applied to items, and then you have to really focus on these kinds of things. But very often you don't need to type these things out, actually. It's kind of automated sometimes. But just so you get an idea, a proper web page often looks like this. It's very, a lot of nesting happening. So this is a container, and another container here, and another one, and another one, and another one. So there's a lot of nesting. It's similar to basically the structure of when you build a file in Illustrator or Sketch or whatever, and you also create groups and nest things in certain containers. Basically, this gets carried to the web page as well. So you want to create some structure, whether it's in your living room or in your basement or on your sketch document or in your HTML file. It always helps to be a bit organized. All right. So let's go even one step further. Let's see what I wanted to say here. I have a bit more information on CSS, but let's not get into this today. It's a bit more complex, but if you want to look it up, feel free to take a look at the slides here. It tells you a bit more about how to actually apply a bit more complex CSS. And you can also ask me, of course. There's a few other properties, and you can look at lots of pages that give you reference, but I listed a few within the slides, so feel free to take a look at those. But I have another thing that I want to show you. I created a little bit of a Instagram-y layout And let me show you here. I'll share this as well. You can take a look. Where's the chat window? 1 second. There it is. Install like layout. So here I just took basically the images of our store oblique and created a layout that looks like Instagram a little bit, but has a bit of different sizing, as you can see, and a bit of different shapes. So I added a bit of funky shapes here and also different sizes. So you can create elements that are actually not, that are actually spanning two columns, and you can put an image in there. So if you are interested, I will leave that up to you. You could take a look at this and change the images here. So it's always an image here that you could change. You just need the URL for it. You can't upload actually an image here to this page, but you could add a URL and change the image here. Let's try that with some image we find on Google about tennis, because tomorrow I'll be playing tennis with Tom, actually. So here is Djokovic. Let's take him, and I'll just copy this link location here. Let's put him into the layout here. So I'll remove this one and replace it with Djokovic. And it might not let me do that with the Google link. That was kind of stupid. I have to first go to the page and copy it from here. Sometimes some web pages won't allow you to do that, but let's try that again. And I go here and replace the source attribute with the source I actually want to use. So it is, there's Djokovic now, squared, because it's now cropped to a square. And I have it here, I created the class for different sizes. So if I do it like this, it's going to be a large, a standard size. I could apply here a circle, it will be circled, or a triangle, then he will be triangular. And I'll make him a bit bigger, like this, or even max, so he will take up the whole row kind of pyramid here. So you could play with these attributes here, adding different class names to the grid item. And this is already a bit more complex, but if I sparked your curiosity, you can try it out here and play around with a few properties. Let's go back to a circle here. All right. So here you see a few different ways of doing it. Okay, any questions? Everybody can start coding now. I hope. Yeah, this is what I have for today. I hope it's a nice intro to a quick one to just at least understanding how it kind of works. Maybe you will get curious and want to try it. And if you do, yeah, let me know if you need help, if you want to learn it a bit better. There's lots of resources you can look at to start learning it. There's actually one Berlin kind of thing. Let me just show you the link to it. It's called CSS classes, this one. It's a Berlin group that sometimes actually even met for beginning CSS, and they have a really nice introduction to each different areas of HTML and CSS. So that one I can totally recommend if you want to just kind of start and get going. Let me actually paste that into the channel. Nice intro here. All right.
Nice.
Let me share here, unless there's some other question.
Thanks a lot. I guess I had a what, like maybe a small question. First of all, thanks. It's really nice to have this as an overview. Also, for me, it's really cool to see this JS fiddle because you could, you know, just start coding. You don't have to worry about all the having an app or stuff like that. You just open it and you go. That's really nice. But I was kind of wondering, like, let's say someone is interested in this and what's a useful, like, how can they start with that? What's an easy next step if you actually want to have, you know, start doing some CSS on your website or, you know, have something online that you've created in CSS Fiddle?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you wanted to actually take it to the next step and publish that somewhere, you would need web space somewhere. So you have a provider of some sorts. There's lots of them. And then they will give you some sort of web space and some kind of info how to access that web space. You would then go to your JS Fiddle, for example, and you would actually have to copy and paste this. Basically, there's no way to export this. There's a way to embed it, but I wouldn't recommend now to use this here and embed it with this JavaScript here, or even with an iframe. It would work, but it's not something I would recommend to actually do. What you would do is it gives you here this HTML output. So you copy and paste this, what's in this box here. And then you would create an actual HTML file that you could then save in some folder on your local computer. And then you would upload it to the web space. So that's a bit of a technical process. But if you're interested in that, just let me know. I would help you to set this up, basically. I know that you know how it works, Daniel, of course, but just for everybody else. So that would be the next step. It takes a little while maybe to get to know if you want to start doing that and writing with an editor or something. It's kind of like learning a new software. But once you know how the steps work, then it's not so difficult anymore as with most things that you try to learn. Yeah.
Do we have any other questions, or did people try it out already? Does the JS Fiddle thing work? No response.
Coding.
Everybody's done going away coding. Helen was very informative. Very nice. She was in view only mode. As far as I saw.
Yeah, cool.
I know. Normally I'm more participative, but I was really sick this week and everything's kind of backed up on Friday and I'm like, the designer's so cool. I don't want to miss it. But yeah.
Yeah, no worries. Glad you made it to the class that you at least could participate. Yeah.
All right, let me at least also stop the recording.